This program is made possible by the partners and friends of Bob Yandian Ministries. Coming up on this episode of Student of the Word.
Praise and worship is a constant thing. It's always coming up before the Father. And I think one of the best things you can do is praise the Lord throughout the day. You say, well, that's really not really prayer. Prayer is communion with God. It's speaking to God. Therefore, praise and worship is communion with God. It can be under a form of prayer of communion with God and God speaking back to us. There's times throughout the day I talk to the Lord.
For more than 40 years, Bob Yandian has been an expositor of the Bible, making seemingly complicated doctrine easy to understand. Grab your Bible and something to take notes with and study the Word of God with Pastor Bob Yandian.
Hello and welcome again to Student of the Word. I'm Pastor Bob Yandian. Glad to have you with us. And again, my hellos to all of you, my thank yous to all of you who watch, all of you who pray, and all of you who are continual givers into this particular ministry. Thank you so much for being impressed by God, but also just deciding on your own, purposing in your heart, I like that ministry. I like what he has to say, and I want to back him. So thank you again for doing so. And whether it's gifts of $5 a month or $15 a month or $20 or whatever you give, because we have givers that go all the way up, I just want to thank all of you because together, put together, we have great offerings and coming in. And so I thank you for your continual support of this ministry. And there comes times we ask for extra from you because like with television expenses or things that come up, you are so prompt to give. I just want to thank you for being obedient to help support the gospel of the kingdom of God and the teaching of the Word of God. This broadcast, along with its ministry, is dedicated to raising up a brand new generation of ministers, young ministers that will take the gospel. I'm not here to teach things that change. I'm not here to talk about what music styles. I'm not here to talk about paint colors. I'm not here to talk about lights in the auditorium or smoke machines or whatever you have. I mean, those things are just things that change throughout all the times. Dress codes have changed. I mean, when I was young, man, you dressed in a suit when you came to church. You dressed in a suit when you were preaching the Word of God because that was honorable to God. But you know what? I studied the Word one day when all the casual stuff began to come along and people were actually dressing in nice jeans and shirts and, you know, just open shirts and untucked shirts and open collars and whatever they were wearing, you know, and stuff. They looked nice, but, you know, it kind of went against my old Pentecostal teaching, you know. But I went to the Word of God and found out one day that Jesus, you know, as I was studying it, that especially in chapter 22, 23, 24 of Matthew, Jesus was on the streets. He went into the temple to teach. He came out of the temple, went back to the streets, went back into the temple again to teach. And finally in chapter 24 in verse 1, it says he not only left the temple, he departed from it. He never went back again. But during those times, I mean, he didn't say Jesus went off the streets and into the temple, went into the restroom and changed clothes so he could look nice, didn't want to go back out in the street, change clothes again. Whatever he wore on the street, he wore right into the church. It's not the outward appearance God is looking for. It's the inward heart. But I am here to teach ministers things that do not change at all. And that is the power of the Word of God and the power of the Holy Spirit. And that's what I minister on, to infiltrate these things in, because styles come, styles go, a lot of things change. And there's nothing wrong with that. That's happened throughout the centuries. Thank God I have a television to teach you with, you know, and thank God I have audio, and thank God I have air conditioning in this room, and thank God we have heat in this room when it gets cold outside. All those things are wonderful. Jesus didn't have any of those. I cannot imagine teaching to the multitudes as Jesus did without a PA system. But today we have PA system, and I'm glad for that. I'm glad we have cars to come in instead of riding donkeys or walking down the wall, the roads and stuff. Thank God for change that comes along and everything improves as it goes along further. Thank God for that. But on the other hand, that has nothing to do with the ministry. Well, that has to do with your own personal taste and what kind of car you like or what kind of clothes you like or whatever. But it does come back to this, things that do not change is the Word of God because it lives and abides forever. And Jesus said, I will send you the Holy Spirit and he will abide with you forever. So there's two forevers attached right there to the Word of God, the power of the Holy Spirit. And so we've come to you, teach you the Word of God. If you would open with me to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, 1 Thessalonians 5:17. When I was in Bible school, our teacher, Dr. Charles Duncombe, I mean, he was such an impressive man. And he just left a really indelible mark on my life. And he just taught me things I'd never seen from the Word of God before. I so admired him. But he was Smith Wigglesworth's pastor in London. And he talked about how they traveled with Smith, told stories you can't find in books and stuff, you know, because he just told stories of things that just happened between him and Smith. But I remember one story he told one time was that Smith was not for praying more than one time for a situation. You pray one time, that's all you pray. And Charles Duncombe was quite the opposite. He said, no, you can pray quite often. They used to get into arguments over this, and both would try to present scripture. I'd love to have been in the room, you know, hiding in the corner just to hear the argument going on between these two. But what Charles Duncombe said was, you know, Jesus prayed for a man more than one time. And so Smith would talk about, well, you just speak to the mountain one time. That's all you have to do. And so I want to come and tell you that, you know, in essence, both were right. What I'm going to say is there's a time when you say it one time. There's times when you pray it more than one time. We're going to just simply get into the Word of God and find this out. 1 Thessalonians 5:17 says, pray without ceasing. And in those few words that we have right there, pray without ceasing, what it's simply saying is, it doesn't mean that you have to always be praying. There can be an attitude of prayer or openness to the Holy Spirit. Most of my days I start out with, Lord, today's going to be a great day. I've got some great things planned for your kingdom. But if I am misstepping in any area or you have a better way for me to do it, I am open at all times to hear from the Holy Spirit. Please lead me and guide me because I can't do it myself. I need the Holy Spirit. And so that's a way that we pray without ceasing. That is a way we pray all day. Someone told me one time they looked into the Greek of this, and I've looked into it. I can find the essence of it, but can't find the actual statement of it. It means to pray with the consistency of a hacking cough. In other words, when do you cough? When it's necessary. When do you cough? When it's necessary. And suddenly something rises up and you need to cough again. Whenever needs pop up one after another, you're always in a state of readiness to pray over every situation. Pray without ceasing. The Bible also says that we are to pray on every single occasion. And what that means is stay open to prayer throughout the day. And that's what Paul was saying here. So again, one says you can pray many times over a situation. One says you can pray one time over a situation. We're going to talk about the truth of that again. Both are scriptural. In essence, they complement each other. This is the story. Look at Luke chapter 18, verses 1 through 8. We have the story here of the unjust judge. The unjust judge. It says in Luke chapter 18, verses 6 through 8, the Lord said, hear what the unjust judge teaches. Shall not God avenge his elect who cry to him night and day, though he endure long with them? I tell you that he will avenge them quickly. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth? The story of the unjust judge was simply a woman was persistent and came and knocked on this judge's door until he finally came to the door. And she was so persistent with him that he finally answered her request and granted her request just for her to leave him alone. And people have used this as a story of God, that there comes an importunity in prayer. And they talk about how you just bombard heaven's door and you're bombing the gates of hell and sending forth these prayers. And you're going to do this because why? God is asleep, basically, and he has to come. He comes to the gate and says, what do you want? We keep bombarding him with prayers. That's not what this is saying. In fact, to be honest with you, Luke looks at a contrast. Throughout his books, a lot of his parables are contrast of the way God doesn't do it. And notice what he says here, God will avenge his elect. It says, who cry to him day and night, though he endure long with them. What it simply means is, there's prayers coming up throughout the entire earth, and we need to understand something. It's all right to come to God in prayer. It's all right to approach him again about that prayer. But we are not here to change God. God's not going to change, okay? That importune judge that was in the story finally changed after enough pressure. God's not going to change through pressure. If he's not going to do something, he's not going to do something, all right? And our importunity is not going to get him to change. Now, our importunity can change us. What I mean by that is the longer we pray, the more we come to God, the more we can be educated. This is okay. But God is not going to change. And in essence, if you come to God filled with faith, fully assured of the Word of God, you can pray one time. But is there a prayer before you come to that? The answer is simply yes. That there's times I have prayed to the Lord later, I'll become more educated in how I was praying and came back and approached him again. And even a third time when I learned more of the situation that was going on and approached him about certain things in that situation. And so, but there's also been other times when I have seen just about everything there is to be seen and I have taken it to the Lord and admittedly prayed one time, said, Lord, this is it. I see what's going on. I understand what's going on, but I'm going to pray this way because this is the way this thing needs to turn out. So I pray in the name of Jesus. Jesus stilled the storm by speaking to it one time, yet he spoke to a blind man twice in praying for him. And what I'm simply saying is it's not God that grows, it's us that grows. And as we grow, we can come back with a more narrow, fine-tuned prayer aimed at the purpose of God and aimed with more the Word of God in it, more of the understanding of where we stand now than we did 10 days ago, 2 weeks ago, 4 months ago. we can better understand it. And though it does not seem like things have changed, we don't come back like a normal man and keep twisting somebody's arm. You can't twist God's arm. You can't come to Him with more passion than before and expect that's going to change God. That's not what changes God. Notice the closing statement says, when He comes back, will He find faith? What God is looking for is faith. And if my faith has grown since 2 months ago to this point, I have no problem coming back to God and approaching Him with more faith about this situation. And that's exactly what happens in the Word of God. Faith can approach God more than one time. But it should be more faith the second time than the first time, and third time or fourth time that we come back to God and approach Him on a situation, we have grown more in faith and have more understanding about what's going on. Because the perfect prayer really is not praying in tongues. I've heard people say that the perfect prayer is praying in tongues. But that's not true. The perfect prayer in the Word of God is praying the Word of God. That's what Jesus did toward the devil, spoke the Word of God. To pray the Word of God, that's what Paul did in Ephesians chapter 1, Ephesians chapter 3. He prayed those prayers for the Ephesians based on the promises of the Word of God and prayed that those promises would come to pass in their life. That's exactly the type of prayer that God is looking for. Praying the Word of God is the ultimate type of prayer. It's taking two things, two spiritual powers, which is the Word of God, and is taking prayer and uniting those two together to where the Word of God becomes our prayer. And so this is what prayer is all about. But you know what? None of us have totally arrived yet. And there's times we start to pray, and honestly, some of our prayer sounds a lot like, God, oh God, if it be your will, Lord, please, just somehow, I implore you, would you answer this request? That's not a prayer that's going to go a long way. Now, sometimes maybe in your innocence, God will answer your prayer, but next time He demands more out of you. He expects you to come and quote to Him what His will is. Lord, I'm praying for this person to be healed. I know it's your will to heal because Jesus went to the cross and bore the healing and the sickness and the disease of all mankind. Therefore, I know by the Word of God that Jesus Christ, it is His will to heal. I also know it's His will to heal everybody because when Jesus went out, they found all the sick, brought them to Jesus, and He healed them all. That has been stated more than once. I know that Jesus Christ was anointed by the Holy Spirit and went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil. I know that sickness is a form of satanic attack, whether it's through Satan himself, through demons, or else through the curse that's in this earth that entered into this earth when Adam turned against God and Satan had a foothold into this earth. He introduced curses, of which one of those was sickness and disease. But Jesus Christ has come back and died for that particular area of sickness and disease, as well as the sin that was introduced at the fall of mankind. We come back to Him with His Word. And you know what? There's times I grow more in His Word, and therefore my faith can be more effective. Therefore, I should put it into prayer, and I pray the Word of God. And as I do that, it simply means what we're happening now is we are getting our prayers in line with the Word of God. And when God hears that Word, He responds to His Word. His Word will not return to Him void. He sends forth His Word to this earth. We return it back to Him in praise and worship and quoting it, but also in prayer. We pray His Word, He heals it, He responds to the voice of His Word. Angels respond to the voice of God's Word. And so again, it comes back basically that if I pray again, I'm smarter than the last time I prayed. This is what God is looking for. When we come back from the break, we're going to take up from this point. In fact, we're going to go to some other verses of Scripture where Jesus prayed for the blind man and prayed more than one time. We'll find out why He prayed more than one time. See you after the break. Don't go anywhere.
The new birth is an inward work of the Holy Spirit. But when a believer becomes filled with the Holy Spirit, there is an outward display. In these 32 MP3 audio lessons by Pastor Bob Yandian, the ministry and gifts of the Holy Spirit are explored in detail, along with their appropriate use inside and outside of the local church. Lesson titles include A Gift of Power, A Word in Season, Gifts of the Spirit, Spiritual Gifts in the Church, The Gifts and Callings of God, The Utterance Gifts, The Prophet and the Apostle. The Gifts of the Spirit USB flash drive can be used on any computer, MP3 player, smartphone, tablet, or car stereo that is equipped with a USB connection. To order Gifts of the Spirit, visit bobyandian.com or call 918-250-2207. If you would like to become a partner with Bob Yandian, visit our website at bobyandian.com and click on Partnership or call us at 918 850-2207.
Welcome back again. Thank you for coming to, again, the second half of this broadcast as we continue on with our subject. And our subject is the importance of continued prayer. Why should there be continued prayer? Let me point out really what prayer is. Prayer is communication with God, communion with God. And, you know, communion with a friend takes, you know, quite a while. In other words, there's a long time. You sit down with a friend you haven't seen for a while, and, man, you'll sit down over a cup of coffee, and you'll end up getting two cups of coffee, maybe a third cup of coffee, because I'm telling you, this thing's going to go on and on and on. You communicate back and forth. And so it is in the Christian life. There's not only times we pray, but there's times we just talk to God and get up in the morning and say, Lord, thank you for this wonderful day. In other words, it starts off with simple praise and worship. We don't have to have actually scriptural terms on it other than the fact that we talk with God. The Bible says when we pray in tongues, we speak to God. Now, you know, in that particular case, we don't know what we're talking about because we're speaking in tongues, but we communicate to God on His level. Most of the time, God communicates to us on our level. He talks to us in English, tells us what to do, or impresses us on what we are to do. There's a communication that should be going back and forth with the Lord. And so we get up in the morning again, say, good morning, Lord. Thank you for the great day, expecting you to do some great things today. Thank you for loving me. Lord, I sure love you. I love you for what you've done for me. But you know what? I just love you for who you are, not just for what you've done. I worship you. Thank you, Father, for sending Jesus to the cross to die for me. Thank you for cleansing me from my sins. Thank you for making me a child of God. But Lord, I just want you to know you are great. And therefore, I greatly praise you because you are great. And so this is the way we grow in the things of God. And of course, again, prayer being a communion with God, there's all types of ways we commune or fellowship or talk with the Lord. And so prayer is only one of them. This particular story we talked about the importune judge, again, what Luke was doing is making a contrast. This is the way the world is. God is not this way. But look what this person did, because this person was persistent in prayer and or in petitioning, came to this judge, and finally the judge changed his mind. Understand, you don't have to do that with God, but he didn't say we don't have to pray more than one time. I'm simply pointing out to you again that we can pray more than one time. I think the best type of prayer is whenever you have time to look at the Word of God, find the promises of God that go along with that. What is your problem? Is your problem finances? Look up some scriptural, you know, essence on finances. Find scriptures that deal with prosperity, that deal with God bringing money into your life so that you can meet those bills. The Bible says, seek first the kingdom of God and all these things shall be added to you. And so things are added to us in life. Those things are things to eat and how to dress and just conduct our life around others. The necessities of life, but also there comes those times when all of a sudden a special need comes in our life. And there's such scriptures as, my God shall supply all of your need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Not only supply our need, we promise he would supply our wants and our desires. What things soever you desire when you pray, believe you receive them. So we can stand on the scripture. When we get to that point where we've seen the scripture, we've quoted the scripture, we have talked about it, we've first come to a point now where we totally believe it, then I believe in that case we should come to him only one time. There's no need. If basically you have grown to a high level of faith in that area, then go ahead and just speak your faith to God and tell him, and just after that walk off expecting, knowing he's going to do it. Jesus spoke once to the fig tree. And the next day when the disciples walked by, they noticed it had dried up from the roots because they saw the change in the leaves. And so that tree had to obey Jesus, even though from the natural, in the natural, it looked like that tree was just the same 5 minutes after Jesus spoke, from the time he spoke, but yet we understand a day later, no, that thing died the moment that Jesus said it. It died at the roots, and it began to manifest itself later on the leaves and the appearance of the tree. So even when you speak one time, don't expect it immediately to change. Now, sometimes it does. Jesus spoke one time to the storm and boom, immediately all the waves were gone, the winds were gone, and that ship was at the other side. Wow, that's a great thing. But because it happened once doesn't mean it's going to happen every time. It can happen again and will happen again, but not next time or every time after that. Most of the time, the Bible says we have need of patience, and after we have done the will of God, which part of that is prayer, we will receive the promise of God. Meaning once we stand and we speak of the Word of God and we hold our ground, and once it's done and we pray in line with God's Word, then the next thing we can count on is the fact it's going to happen. In the meantime, I'm going to go on my way. I'm going to rest in God. It's going to be taken care of. But there's sometimes we pray because the need is so quick and we just feel like an urgency to pray that we pray. And we walk away from there and then later on searching the scriptures, find something else that applies to that. It's all right to come back and apply that to it. You know, I've heard people say, would you agree with me in prayer? And I ask, have you had other people agree with you in prayer? They said, yes. I don't pray, Lord, I agree with this person. Say, Lord, I add my faith to the agreement of the other people that has come to this particular person and they have prayed. Because oftentimes people have this idea, the more people I can get to agree with me, the more we're going to twist God's arm, move heaven, move God, and we're going to make the thing come to pass. And that's just not true. But agreeing in prayer is scriptural. So I simply say to them, as I usually grab their hand and say, Lord, I agree in prayer. I add my faith to the prayer that has been prayed, and this prayer has my faith now added to it. So what I'm simply saying is, I know you prayed before. I just want to join your prayer. And so this is what happens when we pray, and God wants us again growing in prayer. And so again, Luke told us this story about the unjust judge, and in essence says, God is not an unjust judge. God is not unjust in any way. And he's simply saying, even with an unjust person, if you keep pushing and pushing and pushing, maybe you'll get your way because they get so tired of you knocking on the door. And so it comes back to it. I mean, even the mafia gives to the poor. Even the mafia buys favors from citizens. And so in the natural, maybe on the outside, some things that the mafia, the crime lords do look good, but behind the scenes are really evil. And he's simply saying here in this particular verse of scripture, maybe there's evil judges, and we find them all the time. Maybe there's wicked judges, we find them all the time, who buy favors from people. And these people seemingly are caught in their ways, but if you push them hard enough, they'll change. Here's the good news about God. God's always right, always on the right side. God doesn't change, doesn't need you coming and pounding on his table and pounding on his door day after day, saying, Lord, I'm imploring you again, I'm imploring you again. That will not change God. But what will change God is if you come back and there's more faith in your prayer, more scripture in your prayer than before, God says, I'm going to listen to that. In essence, maybe God doesn't see it as two prayers. He sees it as a prayer that has grown and a prayer that has grown and faith increasing, because the Bible talks about ever increasing faith, and our faith can increase, and so can our peace can increase, and so can our effectiveness in prayer can increase. We have it here in this verse of scripture. So if we would petition an unjust judge, why wouldn't we petition a loving God who loves and takes care of his own? So we have to understand the parable of the unjust judge. She petitioned to change the judge. We do not petition to change God, because God will not change, but this wicked judge could be changed. And so prayer changes us, not God. In other words, when we come to God the second time, it's not God that's going to change. We have changed. So we come to him, and with a changed prayer, God hears it. And so God loves us, and he will speedily answer. Jesus prayed for a blind man twice in Mark chapter 8. And in Mark chapter 8, this man was weak in faith. In fact, they took him outside of town. Jesus came to this town, and then when they brought this blind man to him, Jesus took him outside of town. And so when he prayed for him the first time, he spit on the blind man. And this blind man said, I see people walking, but they look like trees. And I've got it back partly. And so Jesus prayed for him again. And this time the man saw totally clear. Now, Jesus prayed twice. The point of it is Jesus didn't change. The man changed. I have to just look at this story in the outward as it stands and look at it this way. This man probably, when they brought him to Jesus, didn't really have any faith at all. These people did. And they said, we're going to bring you to Jesus. He said, okay. And so they brought him to Jesus, but this man didn't trust in the Lord. He didn't have faith in what was going to happen. And when Jesus prayed and there was a partial change, this man suddenly got with the program and said, wow, yes, Jesus perceived that and prayed for him, this time praying for the changed man. He's answering a prayer for a changed man. God is answering your prayer, especially when you change and grow in faith, dependency on him, and resting in him. When you get to that point where you're so resting in God, you say, Lord, I come to you again, but this time I come to you with a full assurance of the word of God. And what happens is, because you have changed, the answer comes, and the second time the answer comes. So Jesus prayed again. The man saw clearly. It would be fine to add to a first prayer if you have increased in faith. And again, I say, it may not actually be a second prayer. It may be just an addition to the first prayer, a growing, and God sees it as one thing, a growth process in your life. There's more than one type of prayer. You don't pray again as if you've never prayed at all. What you pray for is, there are other types of prayer, not just for a specific need. The other types of prayer are for our benefit and for God's blessing. If I need the prayer, The constant attention to his promises and the exercise of faith, this is what causes me to increase. Again, praying for a particular petition or a need, yes, it's best if you're going to pray one time, but you have plenty of time to understand the Word of God, or you've been studying the Word of God when that need comes along. You are fully aware of what the promises are on that particular subject. You know how to approach God in prayer, and especially you know how to approach Satan in prayer, and that is to take authority over him, and that is to rebuke him as Jesus did. Often Jesus didn't pray for people to be healed. He rebuked the sickness and he rebuked the disease. And he did this when it came to Peter's mother-in-law with a fever. It came later on when these men were demon-possessed and he rebuked those demons and they left. This is the way that Jesus spoke to those diseases and sicknesses. And yes, one time was sufficient for that. With the blind man, as we just quoted out, it took two times because the man grew in prayer. Prayer is more than just making a request. Praying for your meal. I mean, I actually heard of a man one time, he says, I don't pray over my meal. I pray for the groceries when I bring them home. I pray for all of the groceries and I take care of that in prayer. And then from that time on, until all those groceries are gone, I don't pray again over the meals. Well, I mean, I think that's a little stretching of the deal, but understand this, praying over your meal should happen at least 2-3 times a day. You can't just say, I'm going to pray one time now and none of my prayers are going to work over my meals from that time on because one prayer will sanctify every meal I'm going to have for the rest of my life. That's just not true. So we pray over every meal. Prayer and praise and worship is a constant thing. It's always coming up before the Father. And I think one of the best things you can do is praise the Lord throughout the day. You say, well, that's really not really prayer. Prayer is communion with God. It's speaking to God. Therefore, praise and worship is communion with God. It can be under a form of prayer of communion with God and God speaking back to us. There's times throughout the day I talk to the Lord. I can't say, well, I only talk to him one time. That's like the guy that says, do you love your wife? Yes. How often do you tell her? I've told her once. She ought to remember it from that time on. No, she likes to hear the fact that she is loved. God loves to hear from us that we love him, and God loves to tell us he loves us. So again, prayer is more than just making a request. The true definition of prayer, again, is communion and communication with God. All forms of communion with God can be considered prayer. Again, there's praise, there's thanksgiving, there's worship, there's fellowship, and meditation on the Word of God. In this way, prayer is continual. And God is looking for us to continually be talking to him and communing with him. And then when it comes to petitions, it's all right if you're growing in faith to come back a second time, even a third time, and come to that petition and say, Lord, I've grown since the last time, and this time I'm going to approach you with more prayer. And so we do that, coming to the Lord. And in essence, the Lord tells us this again in the Word of God. He says, in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And again, the God that we love will answer our prayer. This is what we're talking about. There is a time to pray more than once, and don't feel guilty about it. Just let it rip with more faith this time. Thank you. See you tomorrow.
Bob Yandian Ministries is training up a new generation in the Word of God. Because of your generosity and faithfulness, this teaching ministry is able to change countless lives. You will never know until you get to heaven how many people received Jesus, were filled with the Holy Spirit, healed, or found God's will for their life through your support and prayers. If you would like to contact Bob Yandian Ministries, visit bobyandian.com and click on Contact, or call us at 918-250-2207. To contact us by mail, use the address on your screen. You can order resources, become a partner, or browse free articles and podcasts by visiting our website at bobyandian.com. You can also join our mailing list and receive weekly devotions and the latest ministry updates. Thank you for watching today's broadcast. We'll see you next time on Student of the Word with Bob Yandian.